Let's now turn to recombination mapping, using crossing over as a means to map genes relative to each other. So we'll call this just recombination mapping. And before we start this, let's remember what happens. Excuse me. Let's remember what happens when we look at independent assortment of alleles that are born on separate chromosomes. So if we have chromosomes, say one chromosome here and another chromosome, let's make it wiggly over here. And let's say we have a gene, the A gene here, and there are two alleles. We have a heterozygote here, and to allow us to follow these through, we have a heterozygote here as well. We know that a genotype here, which is big A, little a, big B, little b, and let's put a semicolon there to show that these alleles are carried on separate chromosomes, we know that this genotype will produce four different gametic genotypes in equal proportions. We know that we will end up with gametes that are big A, big B, and those will be one quarter of the gametes. We will end up with gametes that are big A, little b, and those are one quarter of the gametes. And we will have ones that are little a, big B, one quarter of the gametes, and the last quarter of the gametes will be little a, little b. Note these outside ones, provided that this dihybrid was generated by crossing homozygous big A, big B by little a, homozygous little b, then the parental inheritance of these alleles are such that big A comes in with big B and little a comes in with little b. So if that was the original parent that generated this hybrid, then we have A and B coming in together in a gamete, and that is joined to a gamete that is little a, little b. And these come together to form our dihybrid. So the parental arrangement of these alleles is big A with big B and little a with little b. And therefore we could call the gametes produced by this dihybrid with this genotype, we would call these outside gametes. These are non-recombinant. You'll recall we went over this before, whereas this we'll call recombinant. And I'm going to put that in parentheses because they're carried on separate chromosomes, and we normally think of recombination as referring to genes on the same chromosome. But in terms of the original parental arrangements of these alleles, these are recombinant. And in the case of alleles born on separate chromosomes, we see that the recombinant frequency, if you will, is always equal to 50%. 50% recombination. And I'm going to put that again in quotes because it doesn't involve crossing over. It's recombination, but not through crossing over. It's caused by independent assortment. And we have 50% that are non-recombinant. Okay, and of course we could tell what these gametes were if we cross this dihybrid, let's say big A, little a, big B, little b. If we cross that to a tester stock that was homozygous recessive for both genes, then we would easily see the proportions of these gametes produced by the proportions of different phenotypic offspring that are produced. And if you need to review that, please do. You should be able to understand that we would deduce these gametic frequencies based on the offspring of this, say, this test cross here. All right. Or we could deduce those, we could deduce that as well by crossing to another dihybrid, in which case we would expect a 9-3-3-1 ratio, and that would be indicative of these gametes being produced in equal proportions, the recombinant and the non-recombinants. So let's keep that in mind now as we enter into genetic mapping using looking at genes on the same chromosome. So now we've talked about how if we have two genes, let's say big A, and let's have this heterozygous, and now we're on the same chromosome, we can see that the parental arrangement of alleles is big A with big B and little a with little b. Well, now if we look at the proportion of different types of gametic genotypes that come out, can come out of this, and here again we are in this case, we would write big A, big B, little a, little b, showing that these alleles are linked together on the same chromosome, big A and big B, and little a and little b. So what type of gametes could this produce? Well, if no crossing over occurred, or if in meiosis where crossing over did not occur between these genes, we see that we would get big A, big B gametes, and we would get little a, little b gametes. In this case, we can easily identify those as non-recombinant because they have the parental arrangements of the alleles on the homologous chromosomes. But if we have crossing over that occurs, we see that in some chromosomes in gametes, we will have big A with little b and little a with big B. And these are immediately recognized as recombinant gametes, gametes that bear recombinant chromosomes because we've recombined these alleles for different genes. Note that in order for us to detect recombination, we need to have genetic markers. We need to be heterozygous for particular alleles of genes. Otherwise, we would not be able to detect the crossing over event by identifying non-recombinant versus recombinant gametes, again, by crossing, let's say, this individual, big A, big B, little a, little b. This is a dihybrid in a way. We could cross that to a tester stock, big little a, little b, over little a, little b, so that this individual would only produce little a, little b gametes, whereas this individual would produce big A, big B gametes, little a, little b gametes, big A, little b gametes, and little a, big B gametes, four different types. Now, because these are on the same chromosome, and we'll assume that they're less than 50 map units apart, we know that the distance of these genes will be reflected in the frequency of recombinant gametes produced. So this is the essence of genetic mapping then, is to be able to tell be able to identify the frequency with which recombinant chromosomes are obtained, and you can do that by doing crosses. So let's imagine that let's look at our four genotypes here. We have big A, big B over little a, little b, because these come in together from this gamete, and these come in together from that gamete. Here we have big A, little b over little a, little b. Here we have little a, big B over little a, little b. And here we have little a, little b over little a, little b. Now, which are the recombinant, these are the genotypes of the offspring of this cross, of this test cross. Which are the recombinant genotypes and which are the non-recombinant genotypes? We can easily identify those. We see that this genotype would have a non-recombinant, would have been produced from a non-recombinant bearing gamete, as would this genotype. So here we have a non-recombinant genotype, and here we have a non-recombinant genotype, whereas these two are recombinant, and they result from the fertilization of one of these recombinant chromosome-bearing gametes by a gamete contributed by the tester strain. You should be able to figure that out, and if you can't, you need to review our basic genetics that we've gone over in terms of recombination. So we can map genes then, and let's say that the frequencies of these, let's say the recombinant frequency here was 10%. We got 10% of these genotypes, big A, little b, over little a, little b. And we got, say approximately 10% here, and approximately 10% of the reciprocal class of recombinants, that is little a, big b, over little a, little b. And here we would have approximately 40% non-recombinant of this genotype, of the big A, big B, over little a, little b. And here we would have approximately 40% of the non-recombinants that are little a, little b over little a, little b. And we have 40% recombinate, or 40% of the progeny are of that type. Note that these all add up to approximately 100%, which is what you want, because that's the total number of progeny that you get, 100%. So we would say there that the recombinant genotypes that are produced here give us a, we can add up the frequencies here. So we could say the recombinant, one class of recombinant classes, one class was 10%, another class was 10%. So that gives 20% total recombinant progeny bearing, produced by gametes that bore crossover chromosomes coming in from this parent, from the dihybrid. So 20% recombinant chromosomes then that we can that are revealed to us by the offspring here equals 20 map units or 20 centimorgans. We can say then that A and B genes are 20 map units apart based on the frequency with which we obtain recombinant chromosomes coming out of the meiosis of this dihybrid. And that's the principle of gene mapping reviewed for us. And we could have another case where let's look at another gene set. And let's consider that here. Let's say we have let's take the A gene. And this time we're going to take a gene that's kind of closer together here. Let's look at a C gene. Again, heterozygous. And in this particular case, we see that the big A and big C alleles are linked and the little a and little c alleles are linked. Well, okay, in this case, we could say, what then is the frequency with which we obtained the recombinant chromosomes? We know that we're going to get non-recombinants. We know we're going to get big A, big C bearing gametes, and we're going to get little a and little c bearing gametes. That is, we're going to get the non-recombinant gametes. But we're also going to get now recombinant gametes, which have linked big A and little c, and little a and big C. These are the recombinant gametes. And the question is, what is the frequency of these? So let's imagine, how would we tell the frequency of those? Well, again, we would do a test cross. We would take this dihybrid, big A, big C over little a, little c, and cross it to a tester strain, big A, or little a, little c over little a, little c. And we could then examine the genotypes of the progeny to deduce the frequency of progeny bearing recombinant chromosomes coming from this dihybrid. And you can just review what we just did for the A and B genes to tell. Well, let's say that these now are, let's say these are approximately 2% of the progeny, of the gametes produced, 2%, as revealed to us by 2% of the offspring genotypes in this test cross being having the big A, little c phenotype, and 2% having, approximately 2% having the little a, little big C phenotype. And then in this case, we would have 40, let's say approximately 48% would be, would have this chromosome, big A, big C, and about 48% would have little a, little c. So together, this only adds up to 4% of the progeny that would be bearing recombinant chromosomes coming from this dihybrid. And in that case, then, we could say the A and C genes are only 4 map units apart. So this would translate to 4% recombination would translate into 4 map units, or 4 centimorgans. And then we could do the same for, let's say, the C and B genes and deduce the map distance between those genes. And in that way, say B is over here, remember B. In that way, we can build up a map of the chromosome based on the position of various genes that are bearing the alleles that we've been monitoring. So we have the A gene here, the C gene here, and the B gene here. We say that this is 4 map units. And we say that if we did this, we would get approximately, what did we say? There are 20 map units apart, so this would probably be about 16 map units. And then the A to B distance would be about approximately 20 map units, distance between A and B. So we can build up a consistent genetic map. Now let's look at how this could take place in real life. Let's look at a real life example and solve a genetic problem. And to do this, we're going to look at data coming from a Drosophila cross. And we're going to be dealing with three different genes here. We're going to be dealing with the vermilion gene, and we're going to have a mutant allele and the wild type allele. And the wild type allele encodes dark red eyes, whereas the vermilion allele encodes bright red eyes, or vermilion. So let's look at that. This is one pair of alleles that we'll be looking at. So let's look at that right now. Okay, here's some different eye color phenotypes of Drosophila flies. And this happens to be the homozygous vermilion genotype that produces, excuse me, we're just going to call that V, actually. So we're going to have vermilion over vermilion. The homozygote has really bright red eyes. This happens to be vermilion plus wild type over vermilion plus, or vermilion plus over vermilion, because the vermilion mutation that produces these bright red eyes when homozygous is recessive to the wild type allele, which produces dark red eyes. And there are other eye phenotypes here, but we're really going to be concerned with the vermilion phenotype. And then let's look at another gene here. So this is the cross veinless gene. And here is a normal wing of a fruit fly. And you notice that the wing has veins in it that provide structural support for this very thin gossamer-like wing. It's only two cell layers thick and is quite transparent. And you'll note that there are longitudinal veins in the wing, but there are also cross veins in the wing. This is the anterior cross vein and this is the posterior cross vein. So this would be a cross veinless plus over cross veinless plus phenotype, wild type in other words, or a cross veinless plus over cross veinless heterozygote, because the cross veinless mutation is recessive to wild type. Whereas a cross veinless over cross veinless mutant homozygote lacks these cross veins. The anterior cross vein and the posterior cross vein are missing. So that's why this gene is called cross veinless. So we'll be dealing with this pair of alleles as well. And then let's look at one more set of phenotypes here. This is the cut gene. So cut can be wild type, cut wild type over cut wild type, or cut wild type over the mutation cut, produces normal wings that have intact wing margins, nice rounded smooth wing margins here. But a homozygote for the cut mutant, and the cut mutant being recessive to the cut wild type allele, has scalloped wing margins. They're in other words, it looks like someone has taken a scissors and cut the wings. They have a cut or notched phenotype. And sometimes it only shows up on one wing. This wing on this individual happens to be fairly smooth, but this shows the clear cut phenotype. So the cut phenotype then is a wing phenotype. So those are three different alleles that we're going to be dealing with. Three different genes, I should say, that we'll be dealing with. Cut, cross veinless, and vermilion. One is an eye color governing gene, and the other two genes are govern features of the wing. So let's pick that up next and look at how we would look at a three-point cross and map these genes relative to one another. So in doing these three-point crosses, or any mapping experiment, it's very important then that you realize what the non-recombinant chromosomes are going to look like. So let's imagine we have a gene here, big A, and we have, let's say, little C, and we have big B. So we have three genes, A, B, and C, and they're positioned as such on the chromosome. Well, we can then say that big A is linked to little c, and these two are linked to big B. So let's for convenience sake, let's color code the homolog, and let's say we are triply heterozygous here. In order to do mapping experiments, you must have allelic differences. So here we have little a, big C, and little b. So we are a trihybrid here. We're heterozygous for three genes on the same chromosome. These are linked genes. And this color coding allows us to follow what happens in terms of recombination. So let's imagine that we have a recombination event between A and C in to produce one type of recombinant chromosome. Well, then what we can do is draw the resulting chromosomes that would come out of this, both allelically and chromosomally. So we would say then that in that recombinant chromosome, we would have big A, and then that would be linked to big C, and then that would be linked to little b. So that would be this chromosome here. That is, in terms of regions, if we call region 1 between A and C genes, and region 2, maybe I should put it down here. So region 2 is between the C and B genes, and region 1 is between the A and C genes. We'll call that region 1. So this is a crossover in region 1, and it produces one chromosome, which is big A, big C, little b, whereas the reciprocal crossover chromosome is going to be little a, and then linked to little c here, little a, little c, and big B. Both of these are recombinant chromosomes because they have reshuffled the allelic arrangements. And if we were to be able to color the chromosomes and the alleles that they bear, we can easily see that they are recombinant chromosomes. So we're going to use this color trick to follow our vermilion, cross-veinless, and cut genes in a three-point test cross and look at and map those genes relative to one another. But there's one thing I want to consider before we do that, and that is when you are mapping three genes simultaneously in a three-point test cross, let's draw it like this, big A, little c, big B. And let's draw our other chromosome like this, little a, big C, and little b. So that's the allelic arrangements that we have here. In this case, the non-recombinant chromosomes are going to be big A, little c, and big B, and little a, big A, little c, big B, little a, big C, and little b. We need to consider what happens if there is a crossover both in region 1 and in region 2. This would be a double crossover event, both in region 1 and in region 2. So let's look at the chromosomes that we get out of that in that case. In that case, what we would have is, in this chromosome, this recombinant chromosome, we would have A, and then we would cross over and pick up big C, and then we would cross back over and we would get big B again. Whereas the reciprocal chromosome is going to look like this. And black in the middle. And that is going to be little c. And this is going to be little a. And this is going to be little b. That is, little a crossover in region 1 picks up little c. And then back, a double crossover picks up little b again. These are double recombinants, DRs, double recombinants. And you'll notice that in this particular gene order, where we have the A, C, and B genes arranged thusly, the double recombinants, in terms of the original parental alleles, this looks like it's non-recombinant between A and B, in that it has both the black big A allele and the black big B allele here. And so this looks non-recombinant with respect to the A and B genes. But in fact, they are double recombinants because they have crossed over both in region 1 and region 2. So that is something very important to consider. And double recombination will be, by definition, rarer than single recombinants. Because if we have a probability of a crossover event occurring in region one, and some probability that a crossover will occur in region two, the chance of both of those occurring is the probability of a recombination event in region one times the probability of that event occurring in region two will be the probability of a double recombination, a double crossover. So this, the double crossovers are going to be rare with respect to the single crossovers. And that's something to keep in mind now as we progress forward. And the existence of double crossovers allows one, in fact, to, once identified, to determine the gene order. So let's take our vermilion cut and cross veinless genes. And we could, if we don't know the gene order, which is usually the case, we don't know the gene order, we could look at what the double recombinant classes would be, and that will tell us the gene order. So if the gene order is like this, vermilion cut cross veinless, and we have a parental genotype of vermilion, if we have vermilion cut plus and cross veinless plus on brought in by one parent, and the other parent would be vermilion plus cut and cross veinless, that is, we have a trihybrid here. If this is the gene order, vermilion cut and cross veinless, then the double recombinant chromatids would be vermilion cut and cross veinless plus, if this is the genotype that we start with. So again, if this is the gene order, vermilion cut cross veinless, then the double recombinants would look like this, vermilion cut cross veinless plus, provided that the linked genes as they came in came from vermilion cut plus and cross veinless chromosomes. And then the opposite homolog in this trihybrid would be vermilion plus cut and cross veinless. Then the reciprocal double recombinant would be vermilion plus, cut plus, and cross veinless. Whereas if the gene orders were different, cut, vermilion, cross veinless, we would have different arrangements of the double recombinant chromatids. So that's something to keep in mind as we go forward now and show how you would do a three-point mapping test cross. So let's continue with that right now. And let's look at the following. Here we have our vermilion gene, which we have two alleles, vermilion plus, red eyes, vermilion eyes, the bright red eyes. Cross veinless, wild type is normal wing veins, whereas cross veinless mutants have missing cross veins, and vermilion is recessive to vermilion plus, and cross veinless is recessive to cross veinless plus. And then the cut gene, which has wild type allele, or the cut allele, which has snipped wing margins. And for convenience here, we're going to follow these genes through on by color coding them. So we cross a stock, which is vermilion plus, cross veinless, and cut. That is, it would have a wild type eye color, dark red eye color, because of the being homozygous for the vermilion plus allele. It would be have cross veinless wings, and it would have cut wings. And here we have a vermilion cross veinless cut plus stock, which has vermilion eyes, normal wings in terms of their cross veins, and normal wings in terms of their wing margins. So we cross these two stocks that are true breeding, and we create a trihybrid. And note that the parental arrangement of these alleles are V plus, CV, and cut, versus V, CV plus, and cut plus. So here we have the recessive mutant eye color allele with wild type alleles for the wing genes. And here we have the reciprocal. So if we could paint these alleles, if you will, color these ones red, brought in together, and these ones purple, brought in together, then in the triple, in the trihybrid, we would see that we had vermilion plus heterozygous over vermilion, cross veinless over cross veinless plus, and cut over cut plus. And these are color-coded, showing that the red alleles all came in together on the same chromosome, and the purple alleles all came in together on the same chromosome. And then we take this trihybrid and cross it to a triple recessive stock, which is basically allows us to test cross, and this is a three-point test cross since we are looking at three genes simultaneously. And the progeny will reveal to us what has happened in terms of the parental chromosomes over here. So let's see what happens. So we're going to look at the progeny from this test cross. And we know what will have happened in the gametes, in production of gametes here, based on the alleles that are recovered in an offspring as revealed to us by the offspring's genotype, because the only gametes that this test stock will produce are going to be triple recessives. So we will be able to tell what the chromosome coming from the trihybrid from the trihybrid will be, what the chromosomal genotypes were, because they will be revealed over the recessive a chromosome inherited from the test stock. So here we have a non-recombinant vermilion cross-veinless plus cut plus chromosome revealed to us as non-recombinant because these genes are the arrangement, these alleles are the arrangement that was inherited on the same chromosome from this parent up here. So they are non-recombinant. We say they're non-recombinant. Whereas the reciprocal would be vermilion plus cross-veinless and cut, which inherit all three of the red alleles, and those red alleles have not been broken up by recombination in any way. And we see that together, these non-recombinant phenotypic classes represent about 80%, a little over 80% of the progeny. Now let's be very clear about what's going on here, because the entire analysis will depend on this. What we're saying is that these purple alleles all came in together on the same chromosome, vermilion, cross-veinless, in this case cross-veinless plus allele, and the cut plus allele. And that was the chromosome as contributed by this parent in these individuals. So this chromosome now is in these individuals. And likewise, there was a chromosome that contributed by these parents that was vermilion plus, cross-veinless, and cut. And these red alleles came in together, and this chromosome is present in these individuals as well. So that when we cross the gametes that are produced by this trihybrid with the triple recessive test cross stock, the phenotypes of the progeny will reveal to us the chromosomes that were inherited from this trihybrid. And here we have two non-recombinant classes. But if we were to look now at a recombinant class that would be produced, let's say, by crossing over here between, say, this purple chromosome here with vermilion cross veinless plus and cut plus over vermilion plus cross veinless and cut, then we're going to be able to produce recombinant chromosomes that would have vermilion, the purple vermilion allele linked with cross veinless and cut, for example. And so the presence of these various alleles will be revealed to us over the chromosomes coming in from the tester stock. Now, I've drawn them in this particular gene order, but at this point, we don't know the gene order that these are in along the chromosome. So let's start our analysis of recombinant chromosomes coming in from this trihybrid. Here's a case where we have the vermilion allele here, purple, with the cross-veinless allele, red, and the purple cut plus allele. So if we were to ask what genes these individuals represent crossovers of, we would say they represent crossovers between the vermilion and cross-veinless genes because they have the non-parental arrangements of these alleles as inherited from this trihybrid. We have a purple vermilion with a red cross-veinless. And likewise, these individuals bear a chromosome that is also recombinant between the cross-veinless and cut genes because we have a red cross-veinless gene with the cut plus purple gene. We're color coding these so we can follow them through. So this is a recombinant chromosome, and it's recombinant between these genes. Likewise, here's the reciprocal class of those, vermilion plus with cross-veinless plus cut, and those represent, again, crossovers between vermilion and cross-veinless and cut. These are the reciprocal recombinant chromosomes, if you will. And they are about 3% of the progeny. Then we have two more classes, each being about 6% of the progeny, where we have vermilion with cross-veinless and cut, and vermilion plus with cross-veinless plus and cut plus. So these are recombinant chromosomes between vermilion and cross-veinless and vermilion and cut. Vermilion and cross-veinless, vermilion and cut, because they show they have the non-parental arrangement of alleles for those loci, for those genes. And then we have a very small percentage of progeny, which are either vermilion cross-veinless plus cut or vermilion plus cross-veinless cut plus. And we at first identify these as recombinant between vermilion and cut because there's a purple vermilion allele and a red cut allele. And between cross-veinless and cut because there's a purple cross-veinless allele and the red cut allele. And likewise, we identify these individuals as bearing recombinant chromosomes between vermilion and cut and cross-veinless and cut because of the arrangement of their alleles. So we then can calculate recombination frequencies. We're going to add up all our recombinant frequencies, not our non-recombinant frequencies, and divide by the total. So we're going to identify our recombinant classes of progeny and the numbers of progeny, and divide by the total number of progeny to get recombination frequencies. But we're going to do so because we have three genes, there are two regions at which crossing over can occur. We're going to do that for both regions. So let's begin this analysis. We say, okay, between vermilion and cross-veinless, let's add up the recombinant progeny. Well, we've identified vermilion and cross-veinless crossovers in row 3 here. We've identified vermilion cross-veinless crossovers in row 4, in row 5, and row 6, and that's it. The others we haven't identified as being crossovers between vermilion and cross-veinless. So we add up rows 3, 4, 5, and 6 individuals, 268 that adds up to, divided by the total, which is 1,448 progeny, if we were to sum this column, and that equals 18.5% recombination between vermilion and cross-veinless. Okay, great, that was easy to do. We just determined what our recombinant chromosomes were, and we determined for the vermilion and cross-veinless genes, which represented crossover chromosomes, which progeny bore recombinant chromosomes. And then we just took those total number of recombinants and divided by the total number of progeny to get a frequency of recombination between vermilion and cross-veinless. We can do the same thing for vermilion and cut. And we can just go through here and go through these. Are these row 3 individuals recombinant for vermilion and cut? No, they aren't. They have the purple vermilion allele and the cut plus allele, both being purple. And likewise, these are not crossovers between vermilion and cut either. But these are the row 5 and 6 are definitely crossovers between vermilion and cut. So there's 89 and 94, that's 89 and 94. And we are also identified 7 and 8 rows as being crossovers between vermilion and cut as well. We did that right here. And so we're going to add those in as well, 89, 3 and 5. So we end up with 191 progeny bearing recombinant chromosomes between that represent recombination between the vermilion and cut genes, and that comes out to 13.2%. Okay, what about our last combination of alleles? What about between cut and cross-veinless? Well, we can go through our rows again here. Are these recombinant between cut and cross-veinless? Yes, these were. So we say, okay, those were. These were cross-veinless and cut. And these were cross-veinless and cut. So we have those individuals and these individuals. That is 45 plus 40 plus 3 plus 5 equals 93. 6.4% recombinant between cut and cross-veinless. So we have, in terms of pairs of alleles, we have three different recombination frequencies, should say, between pairs of genes. And those are the recombination frequencies that initially we map and can build an initial map that reflects the distances between these genes, vermilion, cross-veinless, and cut. So we say the genes must be on the same chromosome. Now, why is that? We say that because the recombination frequencies are smaller than 50%. You will remember that 50% recombination was the type of the frequency of recombination recombination that we got when we were looking at genes that were carried on separate chromosomes. We saw that independent assortment, and you can go back and review this if you'd like, we saw that independent assortment yields 50%, basically reshuffling of the parental arrangement of alleles. So since here we have less than 50%, we know that these genes must be on the same chromosome and must be, all three genes must represent the distance between any pair of these genes must be less than 50 map units. So less than 50 map units because we have less than 50% recombination frequency. That's map units. Okay, good. So far, so good. Let's continue. We can build the following map. The distance between vermilion and cut, we said, was 13.2%. So 13.2 map units separates vermilion and cut. And the distance between cut and cross-veinless, we measured at 6.4%. The recombination frequency between those genes was 6.4%. So we say that the genes are 6.4 map units apart. And then we say that the vermilion and cross-veinless are 18.5 map units apart based on their recombination frequency. But we have a problem immediately. You say, well, this map is not consistent because 6.4 map units and 13.2 map units add up to 19.6 map units. Yet we only measured the recombination frequency for the outside genes here, vermilion and cross-veinless, as 18.5 map units. So what is going on there? Note first, though, that we were able to order these genes on the chromosome. Cut is in between vermilion and cross-veinless because the greatest recombination frequency was between vermilion and cross-veinless, and both cut and cross-veinless and cut and vermilion had smaller recombination frequencies. That places cut in the middle of the vermilion and cross-veinless genes. But why don't these add up correctly? Why don't we have a recombination frequency for between vermilion and cross-veinless of 19.6%, which is what we would expect from the individual single recombination frequencies between cut and cross-veinless and vermilion and cut? So why is that? Why is the measured distance between vermilion and cross-veinless less than the sum of the measured vermilion cut and cut cross-veinless distances? Why is that? And the answer lies in our double recombinants. We now realize that these very rare individuals will actually represent double recombinant events. And the reason they're so rare is because they are double recombinant events. Remember, we talked about the rarity of double recombinants compared to single recombinants because the probability of getting a crossover in each of two regions is the product of the probability of getting single crossovers in each of the two regions. Think about that for a moment, and that should make sense to you given that we've already talked about it. So these are actually double recombinants. And even though we initially didn't score them or mark them as recombinant between vermilion and cross-veinless, they were. They were recombinant between vermilion and cross-veinless. It's just that they were doubly recombinant. And so we didn't score them as recombinant, but they, in fact, they were. And you'll remember back, we can go back and review why that is. do that here for a moment. Okay, we see that a double crossover event would not be recombinant between the outside genes because they would a recombination event would occur in region 1 and in region 2, and it would restore the original parental arrangement of these outside genes alleles. And that's why we didn't recognize them as recombinant between vermilion and cross-veinless at first. So let's go through this now and go back to our data here. And so those now we recognize as double recombinants, and we do that based initially on their very, very low frequency. So now we need to add in, since they are double recombinants, we need to add in these 3 and 5 plus 5 individuals times 2, because not only are they singly recombinant between vermilion and cross-veinless, they're doubly recombinant between vermilion and cross-veinless. So we have to double the number of progeny that are double recombinants between those alleles. And that comes then out into 19.6%. And so we have our vermilion and cut distance is at 13.2, our cut and cross-veinless distance is at 16.4, and now our map is internally consistent. That is, we have 13.2 map units between vermilion and cut, 6.4 map units between cut and cross-veinless, and indeed we see that vermilion and cross-veinless are separated by 19.6 map units when we take into account the double recombinants. There's one last feature we need to account for in our trihybrid cross. We could ask ourselves, well, we got 8 recombinants out of a large number, 1,400 plus progeny. What would be the expected number of double recombinants that we would get based on the probability of getting a recombination event in region 1 individually and in region 2 individually? So we would say, well, the probability of getting a crossover in region 1 is 0.132, that is 13.2%. The probability of getting a crossover in region 2 is 6.4%, or 0.064. So if we multiply that probability times that probability, we expect a double recombination frequency of 0.0084 times the total number of progeny. We expect 12 double recombinants, but we only got 8. 3 plus 5 double recombinants. We only got 8, at what we would expect 12. Why would that be? Why would that be? And the answer is interference. And that is when you get a crossover event in one region. So if we're dealing with looking at chromosomes here and we're looking at markers, I'm just going to say A and let's say C and B. Just this is the arrangement of alleles here. And if you get a crossover in region 1 here, then that reduces the probability that you will get a simultaneous crossover in region 2. In other words, crossovers in a given region can inhibit crossovers in downstream regions or upstream regions near them. Likewise, you could say if you get a crossover in 2, that inhibits the crossing over in region 1. So we call this chromosomal interference, and we define interference, we quantify interference by saying interference is equal to 1 minus a coefficient of coincidence, the coefficient of coincidence. And what the coefficient of coincidence is, 1 minus, it is the observed number of double recombinants over the expected number. So our observed was 8, and our expected was 12. So our coefficient of coincidence then is going to be 8 divided by 12, which is 0.66. So our interference value here equals 1 minus 0.66, or that equals 0.33. So that is this number here. That is our interference value. We have interference of 0.33. And this is why we do not get the expected number of double recombinants. Nevertheless, we are able to build up a consistent map where all the recombination frequencies, map distances, add up to consistent values. So that is our three-point test cross, and that is where we will end our discussion of our review of genetics before moving on now into molecular biology.